welcome to this first talk about Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. I thought this would be quite a fun piece to finish the term with, and we'll see how we get on. To start off with, I'd like to just sort of do an introductory talk about some of the people who were involved in making this piece of music come into being. Obviously, George Gershwin is a very important person because he wrote the thing, but he wasn't the person who came up with the idea. The person who came up with the idea was a man called Paul Whiteman, who started off as a viola player and then became a conductor and had his own orchestra. And his orchestra was a sort of light dance orchestra, and he was very interested in jazz. And he got into thinking that he'd like to bring jazz into the mainstream, sort of crossover, if you like, or sort of outreach, and trying to make jazz respectable. So he had this idea of organising a concert in which he would present jazz, as it were, in a formal, normal concert setting rather than in a club, and take it out of the back streets and put it somewhere respectable. And he wanted Gershwin to write him a sort of concerto-type piece. This idea of making jazz respectable is not what Whiteman, it's not the language that Whiteman used at all to describe what he was doing, but essentially that was what was going on. And this is a sort of element of controversy about Whiteman. Now, what I've got here is the encyclopedia entry about him. It says that his place in the history of early jazz is controversial. His detractors, the people who are against him, suggest that his ornately orchestrated music was jazz in name only and co-opted the innovations of black musicians. Defenders note that Whiteman's fondness for jazz was genuine. He worked with black musicians as much as was feasible during an era of racial segregation. Now, this is the issue, and this is what makes this very appropriate for us to be talking about this piece at a time when we're seeing demonstrations about Black Lives Mattering and the role of black people in America. Of course, it's more global than that, but we're focusing on America at the moment. When this piece was written, there was segregation in America. Black musicians could play in certain clubs and would be admitted through the artist's door, but could not go through the front door and sit in the audience. And so the status of black musicians as opposed to their white counterparts was very different. And jazz was their music, really. And so to have a white band leader trying to sort of popularize it and really, for want of a better word, make it more white is a controversial thing. His bands were largely white players, some of the most esteemed white musicians, and his groups handled jazz admirably as part of a larger repertoire. So this is the controversy. Of course, it also needs to be said that the Gershwins were also aware of these inequalities and this discrimination and this segregation. And the most public statement they made in opposition to it, really, was to insist that performances of their opera, Porgy and Bess, must always have an all-black cast. And to this day, that still stands. So although these musicians were working in a segregated time and had limited powers to change things, they often did what they could. I think it's good that we finish here with a quote from Duke Ellington, who said that Paul Whiteman was known as the King of Jazz, and no one as yet has come near carrying that title with more certainty and dignity. So Duke Ellington, one of the most famous and influential band leaders of the early and mid 20th centuries, recognise Paul Whiteman's contribution to the role of jazz and the position and the stature of jazz in American music. And he was working at a difficult time, a controversial time. So this is the context, this is a part of the context of what we're looking at with Rhapsody in Blue. Anyway, how did he get Gershwin to write the piece, and why did he get Gershwin to write the piece? He'd already had one concert where he tried to present jazz in this sort of formal concert setting, and he'd booked the Aeolian Hall in New York for a concert in February. Now, he spoke to Gershwin about writing a piece in November, obviously before the concert. So we're in November, December, January, February, basically 4 months. And initially, Gershwin said that's not enough time because I'll have to make revisions And 4 months is not enough time to write a piece of music, try it out, and then make the necessary changes. So he said no. There's probably a little talk to be had in people who, first of all, refuse to do what they're asked to do. Another very famous one is Stravinsky, who refused to write Pulcinella. Different story for a different day. Anyway, a couple of months after that, the Gershwin brothers, Ira and George, were in a billiard hall. George was playing against somebody else, and Ira picked up the New York Tribune, which is the New York newspaper, and he saw an article that was called What is American Music? And it said in the article that George Gershwin was working on a jazz concerto for Paul Whiteman's concert in February. Well, that was news to Ira Gershwin, and it was news to George Gershwin, because he hadn't written a note and he'd said he wasn't going to write it. So what do? You ring up the guy who said that you're doing something and you ask him what's going on. So they called him up the next day, and Whiteman explained that somebody else was stealing his idea, was going to try and put on a concert of jazz music. This was his rival, his great rival, Vincent Lopez. And so Whiteman felt that he was being bounced into putting his concert together, and so he was bouncing Gershwin into writing a contribution to the concert as well. So Gershwin eventually gave into the inevitable and said yes, he would do it. So Paul Whiteman is the reason that there is a Rhapsody in Blue. Now then, Gershwin basically wrote the whole thing as a piano piece, and then he handed it over to Ferdy Groffé. I hope I've pronounced his name correctly. He's a very important player in this game because he orchestrated the whole piece. Gershwin started writing the piece on the 7th of January, says it took him a few weeks to write it. So a few, I'm assuming, is more than two. Let's say it's 3 weeks, 7th of January, 14th, 21st, 28th of January. That gives Groffé a week to do the orchestration, and he finished it by the 4th of February. So he worked pretty hard as well. I've put Ira Gershwin up because the piece, when George Gershwin was working on it, was called An American Rhapsody. But Ira went to an art exhibition of paintings by Whistler, and he was taken by Whistler's use of musical terms in his titles for his paintings, things like Nocturne in Grey. And so he suggested calling the piece Rhapsody in Blue. So I think we should give Ira credit for that. That was his idea. And then there's another person who you've probably never heard of. He's called Ross Gorman. As we heard at the very beginning of this talk, one of the most famous bits of the Rhapsody Blue is the opening clarinet solo. Ross Gorman was the first person to play it. As it was put on the stand in front of him, after Groffé had orchestrated it, it starts with just a scale. And he thought it'd be a bit of a lark, a bit of a joke, to make it a glissando. So, purely in a spirit of fun, he did that glissando. Gershwin liked it and insisted that he did it every time, and that became part of the piece. But we really should credit Ross Gorman with that, rather than Gershwin. Gershwin had the sense to recognise a great idea when he heard it. And then, of course, we have George Gershwin himself, who wrote this piece. He was the soloist at the first performance, and rather in the manner of Beethoven, he made up the piano part in the performance. Beethoven did that with his early concertos. A lot of it wasn't written down. There are bits in the score for the first performance where the direction for Paul Whiteman is just wait for nod. There's kind of no music to look for, so he just has to listen to Gershwin, wait for the... bring the band in. So it was all done very quickly, last minute job, bit of a rush job. But in this concert, it was the standout hit of the whole event. And what a concert it was. It was called An Experiment in Modern Music, and it was supposed to be an all jazz concert. I would love to hear a recording of it. Unfortunately, I don't think there is one. It ended with Elgar's Pomp and Circumstance No. 1. Goodness knows what that sounded like. It was supposed to be an educational experiment, so I do feel there's an element of sort of outreach here. And what Whiteman said was that it would at least provide a stepping stone, which will make it very simple for the masses to understand and therefore enjoy symphony and opera. So again, that's a rather dubious idea, isn't it? That somehow by introducing people into music in this sort of soft way through jazz, they will then go on to listen to the serious stuff. we see iterations of this argument all the time. People bothered about accessibility and making music open, and somehow just sort of telling people about the great stuff and just playing them the great stuff is not deemed to be good enough. That's quite a debate, possibly again for another day, but you will come across that throughout your performing life. The programme was long. There were 26 new pieces of music. Gershwin's was the penultimate piece in the whole concert. I think by the time it started, a lot of people were very weary of listening to new music, and this opening clarinet flourish got people to sit up, pay attention, and as I've said, it was the hit of the concert. And what a concert, I'll say for the second time. Who was there? Well, we have, in the audience, Rachmaninoff, Stravinsky, Fritz Kreisler, Leopold Stokowski, John Philip Sousa, and Willie the Lion Smith. Now, most of those names will be very familiar to you, the great and good of contemporary music of the 1920s. Rachmaninoff and Stravinsky need no introduction. The violinists of you will all know Kreisler. Stokowski is the conductor who's gone down in history as the conductor for the first Fantasia film. In spite of his name, he's actually English. I think he made up the name Stokowski. Sousa was the composer of loads and loads of marches, the Liberty Bell and so on. So a very influential American composer. And Willie the Lion Smith was a stride piano player. Now I find it very interesting that out of those famous names, his is the only black face there. And it's important that he was there. Because this was a representation of the music that he was playing all the time. He was as important in his day as Fats Waller, and let's have a listen to a clip of him playing a bit of music now.
Finger Buster, are you there, Lion? Ready, up to tempo.
Nice to have that clip of Willie Smith playing, because it's a direct link to the sort of music that was around at the time that Gershwin wrote Rhapsody in Blue, the stride style of piano playing. At the time of the premiere, Smith was 30 years old. He lived on till 1973, died aged 79, and that recording that we've just watched was from 1964, but it's still the authentic sound of the 20s. To finish with today, I'd like to just play you a recording of the piece that was made in 1927. So what's exciting about it is the original band, it's the original conductor, Paul Whiteman, it's the original pianist, George Gershwin, and I believe that Ross Gorman is the clarinetist on this recording. I really hope it is him playing, because it would be lovely to think that we are listening to the first man who came up with this idea. Now, a word of warning, because this is recorded onto an LP, a 78, a wax record, you could only get a certain amount of music on each side of the record, and they had to cut the piece so that it would fit onto two sides of a 78. So that involves two things. The piece is cut down, there's quite huge chunks missing, and also they have to play faster than they probably would in a live performance. So there are moments when it sounds a bit scrambled. That said, You can hear that these are quality players, and you get a very good sense of what an amazing pianist George Gershwin was. It was often said of him that he could imitate a whole orchestra by himself on the piano, and he certainly had tremendous facility. So as we're listening to it, I've got a sort of short score and piano duet reduced for piano reduction for duet, which will go past as we listen to it. There will be a few cuts when I have to skip through pages, but it's nice to finish with just the piece played by the people who first of all brought it to life. Next week, we will look at a little bit of detail about the score. See you then.
Thank you. Thank you.